Hachette Audio presents The Traveling Feast, On the Road and at the Table with My Heroes. Written and read by Rick Bass.
For my father, early mentor, heroic geologist, beloved storyteller, and so much else. Prologue. The radio operator didn't like me. She worked the switchboard down in town for my shortwave, which was how people got in touch with me back in the late 1980s. There was no electricity up here then, no telephones, no nothing. Friends dialed the dispatcher's number, and she rang me up on the radio. She was a severe, church-going lady, severe even by standards in western Montana. The radio wasn't like a telephone call. People back in New York or wherever they were calling from thought that it was because they were on a telephone. But out here on the Canadian border, up in the trees and mountains, it was like a live talk show. Everybody in western Montana could hear our conversation, which was broadcast over the radio. And during the short winter days, the long winter nights when entertainment was scarce, that was what a good number of the folks up here ended up doing. Monitoring one another's shortwave calls to hear all the dirt. The radio dispatcher didn't like me because my callers were often drunk and used coarse language. I was too shy to tell them, my callers, that they were on the air, and besides, with many of my friends, so wild. This would only have inspired them to further profanity. I merely quivered and winced, imagining the church lady operator listening, imagining my neighbors listening, imagining, in bouts of winter paranoia, the FBI and the FCC listening, taking notes. Why my friends told me these things in the first place, I didn't know. I hadn't asked to hear them, neither had the church lady, but since I was too shy to tell them, please stop it, the operator and I listened to the editor, Gordon Lish, use the F word like water. Bass, he said, calling to tell me about some new development, as enthusiastic as a twister. You've got to read this. It's fan-fucking-tastic. You fucking got to fucking read this fucking book. The church lady didn't even clear her throat. I trembled at some of the things she had to listen to and wouldn't have blamed her for holding them against me, but I never dreamed of saying anything to any of the callers. All my life I'd been shy, and I wasn't about to change that. Before my move to the remote Yak Valley in Montana, I had lived in Mississippi. One summer there, I attempted to become Eudora Welty's yard man. It was one of the many summers when I was writing, but had not published anything, and did not believe I ever would. I'm sad to say this was not when I was a teenager. This was when I was a grown man, 24, maybe 25 years old. I just wanted to be close to her was the thing. It seemed like the perfect world. I could be close to her, but I wouldn't have to say anything. I could just stagger around in the Jackson heat, shirtless, in her front yard, and perspire, trimming the hedges, mowing the lawn, sweeping the sidewalks and the driveway, like some sort of yard savage. Standing guard is what I imagined it would feel like, protecting her, but more important, just being around her. Why? I hesitate even to try to explain what the work of Eudora Welty, the best American writer never to win the Nobel Prize, has meant to me. Unlike Faulkner, her Mississippi neighbor, the flamboyant curmudgeon and drinker who wrote over-brimming, high-octane prose, Barry Hanna once called him semi-endearingly old blabbermouth, and who traveled the world, Miss Welty stayed for 92 years in her Jackson home on Pinehurst Street, the same house in which she had been born. Writing, writing. I am a writer who came from a sheltered life, she says in her memoir, One Writer's Beginnings. A sheltered life can be a daring life as well, for all serious daring starts from within. It was the music of her prose that moved me, the rhythm, the cadence, the lyricism. Two of what I consider the greatest similes ever written both belong to her. Her description of a bird dog's pink panting tongue being the color of a faded rose, and the sound of cicadas in the early evening being like that of grain being poured into a metal bucket. In the former, I love how she compares the monstrous, there's nothing nastier than a bird dog slobbering old tongue, to the sublime, the archetypal poetry of the rose. And the latter works its way far down into the subconscious, because even though the two sounds are not alike, both are elemental components of the Southern experience, and hearing each stirs a similar home register in the brain. My admiration extended beyond her writing. I'd seen Miss Welty buying a frozen pizza at the Jitney Jungle one time, and had even been impressed by the way she looked at each one before selecting the one she wanted, rather than taking the first one she saw. I figured I could learn things just by being bold enough to breathe some of the same air, but without ever mentioning to her that I was a writer, or rather that I was trying to be one. Perhaps I should not be telling this. I bought a lawnmower and typed up a prospectus listing my services. Mowing, trimming, sweeping, etc. To increase my chances of employment, I gave price quotes that were crippling to any would-be competitors. $2 per lawn, no matter the size. I went from door to door, putting these notices in the mailboxes and the door slots. I would only embarrass myself further if I tried to tell you what it felt like standing on Miss Welty's porch with my little notice. I didn't gain Miss Welty's employ. The closest neighbor who hired me was a man who lived two houses down, but that was all right. It was closer than I'd ever been before, and I could breathe the air as I mowed laps around that delighted man's yard, that man who, for $2 a week, was sure he was getting the better end of the bargain. But I knew better. I never complained about the stupefying heat or about the humidity, and I kept a close eye on the yard two houses down the street. I was getting to breathe that air. I haven't mentioned I had a real job back then, as a petroleum geologist, an executive's job with an office and a telephone and all that nonsense. Often people from the office would drive by in their rich cars and see me out there laboring. It didn't bother me at all, though my savage yard work in that neighborhood was the beginning of my downfall in that office with those office people in their rich cars, which is another story, and one I bring up only to illustrate my point. That shy men or shy women cannot live among people, nor should they try. That summer, I was nowhere near the writer I wanted to be, and I decided if I couldn't write, at least I could cut lawns and do it well, and I suppose I wanted to show that to a real writer. The logic of it escapes me now, but I remember believing that lawn cutting would cure all the awkwardness I was experiencing with my writing. Shyness can be a deadly thing. About the worst case I ever heard of, besides mine, was from a writing student at the University of Montana named Jake, who related the following story to me. One time Jake and his friend Brian were fishing and drinking just outside the town where Tom McGuane lived. The sun was high and butter yellow, a lovely June day. Tall grasses waved on the hillside where they sat taking a break from fishing and drinking vodka. Along bounded a dog, up through the tall grass, wanting to play. McGuane's dog, Sadie, as it happened. She was a pointer, as I imagine it, polka-dotted like a Dalmatian. McGuane was one of Jake's gods. So what does he do in his breathless shyness, in his drunkenness, in the beauty of the day? Jake, whom McGuane did not know from Boo, took a sheet of paper from his notebook and scrawled his address on it. Giggling, he wrote, "Tom, loved your last novel. Let's have lunch, Jake," and then withdrew from his rucksack a story manuscript he had with him and tucked this, along with a note, under the dog's collar. It was a great joke, very funny, and he had Brian laughing, but before Jake could call the joke off and take the manuscript back, the McGuanes drove past in their new blue pickup on the gravel road above the river, the whole family, and the dog took off after them like something fired from a cannon. Mortified, Jake jumped to his feet, wobbly-legged and drunk-staggering, and chased Sadie across the field toward the McGuane's not-too-distant ranch. The truck stopped at a gate, and McGuane got out to open it, and his little daughter looked back and saw Sadie racing toward them. And then, surprisingly, not so far back, Jake, his legs churning, arms pumping. The McGuane family watched as Jake caught Sadie, bulldogged her down in the tall summer grass, wrestled the note and manuscript from her collar, then fled for the cottonwoods along the broad river. That's how it is. You wait and you wait and you work and you work, hoping to be a writer, a real writer. Not as good as the ones you most admire, but good enough to maybe one day go up to them and say hello. But it very rarely works out that way. And if you've got this wretched shyness, You almost always seem to find yourself doing something foolish, rolling around, wrestling a dog, or spending hot afternoons cutting lawns for free when you should be inside writing. It's much better just to go off into the woods and not ever be seen again. Protect yourself from yourself, stay cool, and do your work. You can be the party animal in the next life. When you're shy and a writer, it's not the same thing as being shy and, say, a mechanic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.